Okay, we can start. Good morning to everybody. Thank you very much to join this webinar organized by EW Nutrition that will speak about an important topic from my point of view. My name is Claudio Campanelli. I'm actually the product manager for Master Swab line in EW Nutrition, and I'm following the binders in EW Nutrition. I will do the presentation today about LPS, and with me we have two panelists who will support me, of course, in terms of technical expertise, in terms of questions. And so I'm happy to start introducing them. First is Dottoressa Marisabel Caballero, coming from Honduras, and is actually the Global Technical Manager Poultry for EW Nutrition. Please, Marisabel, if you want to introduce yourself.
Thank you very much, Claudio. I am Marisabel Caballero, and as Claudio said, I'm responsible for managing our global poultry strategy and our range of programs and services. I will be here as a support for Claudio, answering questions and giving support in what is needed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marisabel. The second panelist is Dr. Felipe Barbosa. He's Brazilian and is actually the Global Technical Manager for Swine in EW Nutrition. Please, Felipe.
Thank you, Claudio. Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Felipe Barbosa. As Claudio said, I'm Brazilian, but based here in Germany. I've been working in the swine industry for the past 10 years, and currently I'm leading the global swine technical team for EW Nutrition. Same as Marisabel, I'll be here to support Claudio answering the questions during the discussion. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Felipe. Okay, we can start with the presentation. Today, the presentation will be focused, of course, as I said before, on lipopolysaccharide. Regarding lipopolysaccharide, we talk already a lot, that's clear, but is an important topic, and I would like to give you and to pass different messages, and I would like to speak about what can be the, let's say, the external activities or connected activities in terms of microorganisms which can help the aggressivity of lipopolysaccharides in the intestine.
Let me, Claudio, point out something very fast here, and is that your questions are very welcome into the webinar anytime that you would like to ask a question. So, and this is the work of me and Felipe to answer them. So please go to the Q&A section that you will find in the bottom of your screen, and then you can ask your questions in written, and these questions will be answered in real time by Felipe and me. Some of the questions we will probably like to answer for the whole audience, and in this case we will wait until the end of the presentation to have a live answer to these questions. Also, of course, at the end of the presentation, you will be able to leave some feedback for this webinar in the form of a poll that we will be offering at the end. So, once again, sorry for the interruption, Claudio.
And thank
you for being here. And let's start again with the content of this presentation.
Yes, thank you very much, Marisabel, for this point. It's very important. Be free and to ask question and to write the question in the session that Marisabel indicated. I was saying that we'll speak about lipopolysaccharides and the activity of lipopolysaccharides in this presentation. Therefore, as an outline of the webinar, I would like to introduce very speedily what are the endotoxins, and give the name of endotoxins in terms of a connection with a kind of bacteria that they produce the endotoxin themselves. But the most important topic will be the factor that opened the door to endotoxin. What does it mean? The factor that can influence the aggressivity of endotoxin when the endotoxin are free in the lumen of intestine. Then the activity, the pyrogenic activity of endotoxin themselves in terms of energy and in the term of losing energy of in our animal, and some solutions. Okay, so as a short introduction to bacteria classification, in this slide is a very schematic way what they are the difference between the two large group of bacteria present in the world, the gram positive here on the left and the gram negative bacteria. The differences is that in terms of toxins, that the gram positive produce toxins which are excreted by the bacteria and are active in the environment outside of the bacteria themselves, and they are called exotoxins. The gram negative, that is the topic that we speak today, they are connected with a particular structure chemically called lipopolysaccharides, which are endotoxins. Endotoxins are the part of the structure of bacteria themselves. Okay, so both bacteria can be pathogens or cannot be pathogens depending on the bacteria. But today we want to speak, I would like to speak only gram negative. These endotoxins, as I said before, are a part of the structure of the cell, of the wall of bacteria itself. And in the large number, because we can have until 2 million of lipopolysaccharides present per cell of bacteria, of gram-negative bacteria. Okay? These lipopolysaccharides, these endotoxin chemically are made in this way. There is a part called lipid A, this part, okay, and it is very important to anchor the lipopolysaccharides to the external membrane of microorganism of gram-negative bacteria. Then there is the core, practically, which is an oligosaccharide containing particular mannans and acids. And then there is a chain of polysaccharide. Okay. The structure of lipopolysaccharide more or less is very similar in all species of bacteria, but the only part can be this one can change. But the lipid A is the most important part, because when the lipopolysaccharide is free in the lumen of intestine, it is the part who can stimulate in our immune system, the immune system of our animals, and can stimulate the inflammatory cytokines. In what I would like to tell you now is the concept of bacteria pathogenicity. Because in the end, we said that lipopolysaccharides and endotoxin coming from gram-negative bacteria. Of course, not all gram-negative are pathogens, that's clear. There are also a lot of commensal gram-negative bacteria in the lumen of intestine. But what we are speaking today, we speak about pathogens. And the pathogens, we speak about pathogenicity. The pathogenicity is the ability of the microorganisms to cause disease. That's very important, because we don't have to confuse with the concept of infection. Infection is the multiplication of the microorganism with the host, in the animal, but it's not synonymous of disease. The ability to create the disease is the pathogenicity, and the pathogenicity is directly correlated with the virulence concept. And the virulence can be the invasiveness, or therefore the capacity to multiply in vivo and overrun the target body area. Every bacteria have a target body area, the target cells. The capacity of to grow and to multiply themselves related to the time is the invasiveness, and this very important point in virulence of bacteria. Then virulence factors, in the end, toxins, which can be enterotoxins, which can be simply bacteria proteins, but in the end, these are the most important part in terms of connection with enterocytes. In this case, I would like to give you three examples because I would like to tell you what is the real relationship with between the presence of lipopolysaccharides in the wall of gram-negative bacteria and the activity of bacteria themselves. For example, Escherichia coli, very common in every intestine in all animals. And I repeat, not all Escherichia coli are pathogens, that's clear, but we are speaking about pathogens Escherichia coli, which can divide it in three different important groups: enterotoxin, Escherichia coli, enteropathogens, Escherichia coli, enterohemolytic Escherichia coli. In the enterotoxin, for example, there is no, of course, they express an important adhesivity to the mucosa and enterocytes, but there is no destruction of the structure of enterocytes themselves. There is a secretion, of course, of some enterotoxin, which are thermostable and thermolabel enterotoxin inside in the enterocytes, but in the end there is a interfering to the chlorum pump in terms of physiology, and we can create a secretory diarrhea. The interferences by LPS in this case is really practically nothing, because the LPS is the structure of enterotoxin Escherichia coli and can help eventually in terms of adhesivity. But the most important part for the adhesivity are the fimbrial, K99 and F41. Also, in case of enteropathogen, the situation is different, because in this case we have a secretion of virulence factors like enzymes who can degrade the actin polymerization and the destruction of microvilli, creating osmotic diarrhea caused by the calcium cations who go out from the cells. In this case, yes, we have a particular structure destroyed by these enzymes, and the free LPS present in the lumen of intestine can increase, of course, easily can enter and go easily to the basal part of the intestine, let's say stimulating the inflammation, stimulating the inflammatory cytokines produced. This is the same for hemolytic, because hemolytic also there is the production of verotoxins and also the invasiveness of the bacteria itself in the enterocytes directly. Therefore, there is a structure who is completely and destroyed and in colon in this case, and also the free lipopolysaccharides present in the lumen can have easily a door open to enter in the bloodstream. There is a direct, of course, a correlation between the presence of gram-negative bacteria and the lipopolysaccharides free in the lumen. That's clear, because higher is the population of gram-negative bacteria, higher is the number of lipopolysaccharides free in the lumen. For example, in case of Salmonella, also in case Salmonella is very aggressive in terms of colonization of mucosa, because Salmonella also can help, is using his flagellum to enter in the mucosa, and the fimbriae as inhibition of protein synthesis also in the enterocytes. So there is a quite high aggressivity in terms of invasiveness, but also in terms of production of enterotoxin and bacteria proteins. In this case, lipopolysaccharide is important for adhesivity of bacteria with enterotoxin, especially with the structure, the famous lipid A that we saw before. But is a relative increase the pathology by free LPS, because Salmonella is important, of course, is an important pathogen, but the connection between the activity of the pathogen itself, the bacteria, and the free lipopolysaccharide is not really important. It's more important when the Salmonella is inner in the enterocyte. In this case, the lipopolysaccharide as a structure of bacteria can help to destroy the enterocytes from the internal part. In case of Lausonia intracellularis, we are speaking about swine, in this case, Lausonia intracellularis is a little bit different situation because Lausonia intracellularis, the most important thing is exactly the invasiveness of the bacteria. Therefore, the bacteria is able to enter in the enterocytes, in internal, in the cytoplasma, and to multiply internally in the enterocytes, creating also particular endotoxin and bacterial proteins, and the result is an hypertrophia and the hyperplasia of the enterocytes, and this hyperplasia lead to have a quite a high distance from the bloodstream, therefore there is no oxygen anymore to connected with this part of cells, and the cells die for apoptosi, and in this case the lipopolysaccharides can create an ischemia in the cells that by necrosis and in lipopolysaccharides can open also the door from the internal part to destroy the enterocytes, and the bacteria can go out from the enterocyte itself and they can attach other cells in the intestine. But also there is a relative increase the pathology by free LPS. Therefore, it's important to understand that there is a direct correlation, as I said, between the number of gram negative present in the lumen and the number of free LPS present in the lumen. Free LPS are a problem because free LPS can stimulate directly the inflammatory cytokines. Why? Because the LPS are connected with a tool-like receptor number 4 and with a cascade of reaction can stimulate the, for example, nuclear factor KB, which is phosphorylated, and when is phosphorylated is directly connected with the messenger as a messenger to produce the interleukina, for example, 8 or 6 or 1, inflammatory cytokines. In this case, it's quite easy to understand this phosphorylation because in vitro we can add a colorant, red phenol, for example. Red phenol is able to be bound to this structure, nuclear factor KB, phosphorylated. When the nuclear factor KB is phosphorylated, is able to pass the message to produce the inflammatory cytokines. Therefore, in a fluorescence picture, you can see here in the intestine the cells, enterocytes, and the red part is exactly the nuclear factor B connected, phosphorylated, connected with red phenol, this colorant, which is able to connect only if the nuclear factor B is phosphorylated. Therefore, in this situation, we have an inflammation because in this situation, nuclear factor go to the nucleo and pass the message to produce genetically interleukina 8 in this case. In the picture on the right side, there is less inflammation because the solution was treated by a binder before, and the level of LPS was lower. Therefore, there was no inflammation in terms of phosphorylation of nuclear factor. Therefore, it's important because we can control in ex vivo, what can be the level of inflammation considering the serotype of lipopolysaccharide we take in consideration and the concentration of lipopolysaccharide themselves in the solution that we use to stimulate the inflammatory cytokines in the tissue. But the most important part in zootechnical aspect is that practically what can we do? there are some factors who can, which can also stimulate the number of free lipopolysaccharides present in the lumen. And we saw and we said that free lipopolysaccharides in the lumen can be dangerous, can be a problem because some activity, for example, pathogen bacteria, can open the door to the bloodstream to these dangerous molecules, chemical molecules in terms of inflammation. In this, one of these problems can be, for example, the usage of some antibiotics, because some antibiotics can create the lesion of bacteria, the lesion of gram-negative bacteria. Therefore, when the bacteria is destroyed, of course, it releases a lot of lipopolysaccharides free in the lumen. In this study, for example, different made in vivo, the animals, in this case, we are speaking about rats, in laboratory, the animal were treated with a particular challenge of lipopolysaccharides and with 5 milligrams of different antibiotic, for example, lincomycin. And you can see how in consideration, in comparison to the negative control group, which is treated only with a saline solution, you can see how is higher the level of lipopolysaccharides expressed in microgram per liter and also the platelet counts in the blood of animals. Here we are really close to the risk of septic shock because of course antibiotic kill the bacteria, but in the same time, they create a lot of a number of lipopolysaccharides free in the lumen who can create a really septic shock because the inflammation and the inflammatory cytokines are really, really stimulated. Another important point that we have to take in consideration in order to not to stimulate too much the level of lipopolysaccharides in the lumen is the diet. This funny example, for example, in human, if we have a meal with 42% of energy from fat, we can increase the average of endotoxemia, therefore the number of lipopolysaccharides, endotoxin in the blood, as average around 18%. If the meal is after a meal of 42% of energy from fat and the rest for carbohydrates, we can increase until 70% the endotoxemia in the blood. And the endotoxemia can be measured after 3 hours or 4 hours from the lunch. Therefore, the postprandial plasma endotoxemia concentration is important. And in our animal, it's important to understand and to balance, of course, the energy in our diet in terms of net energy. But the most also a very important thing is to consider the source of this energy. In this case, in this study, for example, we can demonstrate in ex vivo what is the permeability of lipopolysaccharides in the intestine in relation to the different source of energy that we use in terms of fat. For permeability of lipopolysaccharides, I mean the quantity of lipopolysaccharides can pass from the lumen of intestine to the basal part of the intestine per time, per minute. Normally, we consider a minute. But you can see how also here in a group treated with a saline solution, how the concentration of the permeability, therefore, of lipopolysaccharides is lower in comparison to a group with the same level of energy, but the source of energy is different. In this case, it was coconut oil. And with coconut, if I use coconut oil as a source of energy, I have more permeability in comparison to the cod liver oil, for example, group, or fish oil. That's because coconut oil contains more saturated fatty acids in comparison to cod liver oil or fish oil, also vegetable oil. And as much as higher the level and the quantity of saturated fatty acid in comparison to unsaturated fatty acid, we have more permeability in terms of lipopolysaccharides in comparison to a different source of energy with the same level of energy, I repeat, but different sources with more unsaturated fatty acid. That's the thing that we have to consider in terms of diet of our animals. In this case, we are speaking about pigs. Another important point, of course, and that we have always to take in consideration is the presence of mycotoxins in our feed, in our raw material. That's clear and proved that there is a very big interaction between some mycotoxins and lipopolysaccharides in terms of inflammatory cytokines produced and in terms of inflammation. Therefore, in this study, for example, 1 microgram per milliliter of DON created a sort of level of interleukina B production in the blood and interleukina 6. Just because also DON simply, which is a trichotogenase, is able to create inflammation, is able to interfere negatively with the enterocytes and destroy the enterocytes entering the enterocytes. But if we put a challenge of Salmonella typhimurium, which is a gram-negative bacteria that also produces lipopolysaccharides, therefore there are also high number of free lipopolysaccharides in the lumen, the synergistic activity between DON and Salmonella typhimurium can lead to have an higher level of interleukin produced, inflammatory cytokines produced, because there is, as I said, synergistic activity between mycotoxin, in this case, and lipopolysaccharides. Therefore, it's important to have as much as possible feed clean for mycotoxin using binders or other products. One important point that I would like to speak is the heat stress, because this is an external factor. But the heat stress and the stress in general in the environment can lead to have higher also endotoxemia in the animals. Therefore, it's important to maintain the animals in the right level of temperature, in the right level of humidity. And therefore, it's important to understand what is the structure that we have to use in order not to having heat stress to our animals. In this case, in this study, of course, we took in consideration two different groups of animals, we are speaking pigs in this case. One group was put in a thermal neutral condition. I'm speaking about a condition of around 24 degrees with 50% of humidity. And the second group treated with for 2 days with 38 degrees of temperature with 50% of humidity, and the rest of the trial, which was from the 21 day of age to 28, the rest of the trial, they were in a situation of 32 degrees with 50% of humidity. You can see that we could, we increased until 63% the level of endotoxic unit in milliliter in the serum. Therefore, taking the samples of blood of animals, we realized that there is an higher endotoxemia in the group when there was simply treated with higher temperature in the environment. That's a very important point, because lipopolysaccharides themselves can induce a higher temperature in the body. That's clear, because there is a pyrogenic activity of lipopolysaccharides. This is an example. Then when a bacterium, gram-negative, of course, is englobed by a macrophage. And in this case, bacterium can release lipopolysaccharides because the bacteria die. And these lipopolysaccharides immediately by two light receptors are with the cascade of reaction that we said before, stimulate the production of inflammatory cytokines. In this case, interleukin 1 can enter in the bloodstream and can stimulate the hypothalamus of the brain and therefore prostaglandin. In the end, the results is a higher temperature in the animal. So you can imagine that already by themselves, the lipopolysaccharide have a pyrogenic activity. So you can, if we put the animals in a not exactly perfect situation in the environment of temperature, we can, of course, have a worst problem in terms of endotoxemia in the blood. For example, in this study made by with broiler, they were calculated the temperature in cloaca after 3 hours of challenge of 200 microgram per kilo of live weight of lipopolysaccharides from Salmonella. And in this study, the temperature of the broiler increased until 0.7 degrees, roughly close to 1 degree more after 3 hours after the challenge. Therefore, it's quite proved that you can increase the temperature until 2.5 degrees more with the challenge of lipopolysaccharides in the blood. But not only. In this case, for example, was controlled and measured the level of ATP. ATP is adenosine triphosphate, is the chemical energy present in the lumen of intestine. And also in comparison to the negative control group, we lost a part of chemical energy, adenosine triphosphate, in digiuno and ileo until 15% in digiuno and until 55% in ileo. Therefore, the most important things that we want to lead is that if we have pyrogenic activity of lipopolysaccharides, we have of course increase the temperature of the body. In the same time, if we have an environment who can stimulate also the endotoxemia, the level of temperature of the body can lead to lose energy in terms of metabolized energy or net energy for the animal and for performance. Therefore, this trial lead us to consider another trial, for example, made in pigs, where in this case the animal were treated in metabolic cages, in order to collect the feces, urine, and the animal, these metabolic cages were put in calorimetric or respiratory rooms in order to measure the oxygen consumed and the CO2 produced. Why that? Because in the end, we have to understand what is the difference between the gross energy intake and the metabolized energy produced and the metabolized energy used by the animal or the net energy used by the animal. The retain energy. Therefore, the difference is that we can have losses in energy. And you can see here in this case as protein and as fat, considering 6.25 or 9.97 the kilocalorie per gram protein and fat, you can see the group treated with particular challenge of particular challenge of E. coli, the retained energy in terms of metabolized energy is less in all group in total, for example, minus 15% of retained energy in terms of metabolized energy in the pigs. These are very big losses. And also the nutrient deposition in terms of gram per day, also we can lose until 25% of quantity considering an endotoxemia in pigs. That's very important because considering the pyrogenity activity and the temperature, we is directly correlated to the losses in performance. Therefore, I would like to conclude, give you some practices and some suggestion. First of all, we have to maintain the animals in the best environment that we can do, avoid the introduction as much as possible, of course, pathogens by strict biosecurity rules and behaviors as much as possible, limit the stress of the animal in terms of environment, in terms of temperature, in terms of humidity as much as possible, reducing the permeability, therefore, of lipopolysaccharides in the intestine, and reducing also the contamination as much as possible of pathogen bacteria, like I made some example, coli, lausonia, salmonella, but also brachyspira, etc. The diet of the animal is very important. It's very important to consider the sources of energy because we saw the sources of energy can influence the permeability of lipopolysaccharides, free lipopolysaccharides in the intestine. And also maintain the, as much as possible the balance between protein, fats, and amino acid available, of course, energy, etc. Of course, avoiding too fast into post-weaning, we are speaking about piglets in this case. We know very well that from weaning to the post-weaning period, there is a stress for the animal. Therefore, as much as fast the passage from post-weaning to the weaning period, higher is the stress and the permeability and the endotoxemia as an average in our animals is higher. Of course, avoiding as much as possible mycotoxin contamination. That's clear because mycotoxin can also have an important synergistic effect with lipopolysaccharides. Therefore, is important the risk evaluation and very good risk evaluation in terms of contamination of raw material and feed. Also, of course, I would like to suggest to use as much as possible some feed additives able to maintaining and to reduce the presence of toxin. For example, phytomolecules is important because the phytomolecules can also modulate and change the microbiota in the intestine in favor, for example, lactobacilli and reduce the level of gram-negative in the intestine, the pathogen gram-negative in the intestine. Binders activity against mycotoxins and also against bacteria toxins. Preservatives and pH controllers like organic acids, for example, other things like can be prebiotic or probiotic, etc. Therefore, the use of particular feed additives are absolutely important. My presentation is finished. I would like to thank you very much. And I would like to give you some, we have some minutes again for questions and answer. So please don't hesitate to write the question in the Q&A section.
Thank you very much, Claudio, for the presentation. And as you pointed out, we start now with our question and answer session. I would like to start with a question that was repeated several times, and it was about analyzing endotoxins in animals. So I would say that this is a quite a difficult topic, as first of all, we have not really established the levels of endotoxins that start to be harmful for animals. And also you have to take into account that endotoxins are causing these immune reactions or these strong immune reactions only when they are in the bloodstream, only when they are in the blood. So For example, we cannot measure endotoxins in the gut, and the intestine is the most important source of endotoxins for animals. Of course, as I said, they are harmful only when they pass into the bloodstream. So what can we do here? What we can do is to avoid having stressful situations for the animals that would lead to dysbiosis and leaky gut. In that regard, can we measure endotoxins in blood after we have these stressful events? Probably this is what will make more sense if you want to really measure if the animals are having levels of endotoxins that can already be harmful for them. We know, as several studies have been done with injections intraperitoneally of endotoxins in animals, so we know which levels already are causing harm. We don't know which can be, let's say, the limit levels, so the lowest observed adverse effect. Although we have information from several cell lines which are exposed to different levels of endotoxins. This can give us a good idea. But to measure endotoxins in blood and expect to say this is already harmful for the animals or not, well, there are some levels that we can be sure. There are some other levels that we still will have this gray area in which it's possible that there are some immune reactions, but also it's possible that the animal can cope with them. How do we measure the endotoxins? Okay, of course, with many parameters that you measure in the blood, they are very variable in the animals, and they can even, or we can even find variations by the time of the day that we are measuring the endotoxins, if the animals have eaten or not already, and so on. So what we really need is to establish a protocol in which we find out which are the most, let's say, stressful times for the animals and measure in that moment. As an example, for example, in sows, after farrowing, of course, is a very stressful time for the sows. And of course, this period is also associated with fever, possibly also caused by endotoxins. On the other side, if the sows are very stressed, we can find endotoxins in the milk of the sows. This is also an endpoint that is interesting to measure, as then it will tell you that you really have a problem in that case. What we need to do to, let's say, avoid endotoxins is just to try to avoid as much as possible stressful events for the animals, and as Claudia also pointed out, to use some preventive strategies.
Yes, thank you, Marisabel. It's very important. It's not easy, as Marisabel said, to measure endotoxin. Of course, biomarkers is easier because we can measure in easier way, let's say, interleukina present in the blood. But anyway, it's not a daily practice because of course, you have to take blood from the animals, frozen the sample is not, of course, easy.
Mm-hmm. Also, we need a laboratory. So there are not fast kits today that measure endotoxins. We normally do LAL tests in the lab.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, correct. Thanks, Claudio, for the presentation, and thanks for the audience. You have been quite active in this webinar, and we appreciate that. Marisabel and I, we are quite busy on answering all the questions that are here, and we're trying to answer all of them. I would like to take one from Gert. Gert, thanks a lot for your participation. You're giving us a lot of interesting questions for discussion here in this panel. And Gert is asking, Are all toxin binders capable of binding and reducing endotoxins? And if yes, the clay fraction or head of the E cell wall fraction responsible for the binding. What do you understand that, that clay minerals have been successfully used in absorption of especially polar mycotoxins to prevent health problems in pigs? Most of the times we know that. We have done several analyses of one of our products and the clay combinations that we are using in our products. And this showed not only a high binding capacity for aflatoxin, which is expected from these specific ingredients, but also for endotoxins. We have done also some independent studies conducted by different labs worldwide, and most of them, or I can say that it's a quite a standard result for this specific trial, showing that we have extremely high endotoxin binding capacity in the clay that we are using in our product. And most probably this can be explained by the mixture we have created for this specific product. So indeed, you're right. Clay is playing a great role on binding endotoxins and preventing endotoxins to be released. If we look at the E cell walls, and you do know that, and majority of the audience also understand that E cell walls, they are playing a different role. Most of the cases, they can also improve animal health and performance, but mostly by preventing pathogens for binding the gastrointestinal tract, and also for reducing or modulating the gut microbiota. So when we are avoiding then decolonization, you also automatically avoid the production and the transfer of the endotoxins to the bloodstream. So it's a combination of both agents that will reduce the overall contamination of endotoxins in the blood, okay? But you're absolutely right. The clay is most probably playing a major role here.
Yes, thank you very much, Felipe. Yes, exactly. I would like that the most important, mycotoxin who can interfere with lipopolysaccharide are exactly trichotechenes, and trichotechenes are bound by cell walls normally. Yes. Other questions?
Yes, very good answers as well. Thank you for your questions. One question that is also repeated is exactly what Claudio may have started to point out, and this is the interaction between endotoxins and mycotoxins. So, there are some mycotoxins, and especially trichotoxins, that are having negative effect in the gastrointestinal tract, specifically in the intestine. So these mycotoxins can first cause immunosuppression. Second, it can induce apoptosis in the enterocytes, and they can also interfere with the tight junction proteins, with the expression of tight junction proteins. Therefore, we may have first that mycotoxins also may be the starting point to cause a dysbiosis, or may be increasing the presence of a gram-negative bacteria in the gut. So with that, we will have more endotoxins. And in the second place, also mycotoxins can disrupt the intestinal barrier. In this way, they will increase the passage of endotoxins into the bloodstream. And of course, what we can see here is that at least we will have an additive effect when we talk about endotoxins and mycotoxins. In poultry, we have observed in several mycotoxin-related studies these effects. Mycotoxins increase the possibility of disease, and they make diseases longer as well. So we are talking here about conditions very common in poultry, like necrotic enteritis. We know that necrotic enteritis causes a disequilibrium in the microbiome, and therefore we will have a higher quantity of gram-negative and in general bacteria dying. Therefore, we can expect a higher LPS release. And this can be started by mycotoxins. So in this case, we can talk about at least an additive effect, probably for some dosages of mycotoxins, I mean, for some challenges of mycotoxins, even a synergistic effect.
Yes, thank you, Maria Isabel. Yes, absolutely. This synergistic effect is very proved. And also in terms of immune system, no? The immune system reaction is absolutely proved because the interaction between mycotoxin and lipopolysaccharide is measured by the interleukina production. Yes. Other questions we have?
We do have a question here, Claudio, that is more or less related to what you have mentioned. Let me just read the question out loud. It's from Ana Fonseca. Thanks, Ana. So what is the dosage to induce LPS infection, but not endoxemia in pigs? So what is, let's say, what, if I understood your question correctly, is what is the minimum level or the maximum level that we'll have in the animals that will not cause any damage? This is extremely complicated to answer, to be really honest with you, because we can expect different clinical symptoms coming from the contamination with endotoxins, right? In some cases, we do have really low levels. For example, 3 micrograms is already capable to increase the vasodilatation in pigs, especially in when organs that are somehow related to the liver and the liver function are concerned. This really small amount of endotoxins in the bloodstream can already increase the dilatation of the blood veins. So this could be already an indication that something is going wrong. On the other hand, we do have some indications saying that LPS itself in vitro, it's not able to cross the intestinal barrier. And then it comes with Marisabel and Claudio were discussing before, is the whole situation that will lead to a severe, a moderate, or a known appearance of the clinical symptoms. We do have to understand that interactions with mycotoxins, with immune stimulation, with the leaky gut, and everything that is concerned in terms of stress for the animals, and we think about the piglet, and as I said, I'm working with piglets, especially in stressful moments like the weaning, the whole intestine and the microvilli and the gut itself, it's changed. So it's under severe stress. And this could open the doors to endotoxins and to mycotoxins to cross that barrier and start causing problems. We are trying also to understand what does it mean in terms of contamination for this specific animal. So we are also trying to have a look on which levels of LPS, for instance, in the bloodstream of the sows will be somehow harmful for the animal. So there are also a couple of studies showing this translocation, or let's say this transfer from the bloodstream to the milk and therefore to the animals. But to give you a precise answer on the amount, specific amount of LPS, it's a little bit difficult. I'm not sure if Marisabel, if you have something to add of that, but for me, it's quite complicated to say that this amount will be harmful, this amount will not be harmful. So the main idea is, of course, to control and to decrease the overall amount of these specific substances in the gut. Marisabel, I'm not sure if you want to comment something here. Feel free.
Thank you. Thank you, Felipe.
Thank you very much, Felipe. Yeah. And no, in this case. Let's jump into another question and into other topics. One topic that was also repeated is the interaction of endotoxins and heat stress. So do you have anything to comment, Felipe, on that?
Yeah, I think we go back, of course, to the situation that we have mentioned here before. With heat stress is an extremely complicated topic, to be really honest with you. I'm coming from a tropical country, and I know how heat stress can affect the overall performance of the animals. Now, And I have we have here in this audience a lot of people that also coming from countries that have severe summer. And heat stress, we do know that heat stress will cause overall reduction on feed intake, productivity of the farm, and so on. We do also can affirm and we can confirm that heat stress will increase the amount of LPS in the blood. Most probably, it's because of what we have discussed before. There are some studies saying that heat stress, of course, will cause dysbiosis. So the whole gut microbiota will be affected. And this will lead to the leaky gut. Yeah? So it will lead to an opening of the tight junctures of the small intestine. And therefore, the LPS will be then transferred to the bloodstream. So heat stress is, once again, a kind of trigger to this LPS, cross the barrier, and go to the bloodstream, causing, once again, the troubles that endotoxins can cause in the animals. But it's a general situation of homeostasis in the gut, and also environmental protection to these specific animals.
Okay. Thank you, Felipe. I would like to answer to this question relating oil and permeability. What is the effect, dry fat using poultry? Okay, then I would like to ask Marisabel to answer relating animal. Anyway, I assume also the trial that I showed before is in ex vivo with the intestine by pigs, but I assume that the level of permeability more or less should be quite similar, because in this trial the permeability is calculated with the different sources of fats, and these fats, different sources of fat, were treated with bile acids before the treatment of the enterocytes in order to create the micelle that normally and naturally are produced in the intestine in order to absorb the fats. Therefore, we don't have a trial in ex vivo with poultry, but I assume more or less the behavior should be the same. But I would like to listen, Marisabel, about this part.
Yes, thank you, Claudio. And when we compare the barrier or the intestinal barrier in poultry and swine, we can see that in general terms, let's say that swine have a higher susceptibility to endotoxins because they let more or a higher quantity of endotoxins to pass into the bloodstream. In this regard, it is in the studies, we need a higher quantity of endotoxins in the case of poultry. When we are talking about harming the intestinal barrier. And so the intestinal barrier of poultry, let's say, is more resistant than the one of pigs and will let less endotoxins to cross it. Of course, once we have a factor that can increase the passage of material, any material, it can be mycotoxins, it can be bacteria, and of course endotoxins into the bloodstream, this is when we have problems. But if we take, for example, a feed in poultry, and if we take feed ingredients in poultry, we will need to have higher challenges to increase the passage of endotoxins into the bloodstream. So in that regard, intestine of poultry or the barrier in poultry is stronger than the barrier for swine.
Okay. We have some minutes again. We have a couple of questions, then we have to close because the time, unfortunately, is not...
Claudio, just let me interrupt you, because really, once again, I'm really excited with this webinar. We have a lot of questions. We will explain mm-hmm. you how we want to move forward with the questions that are not answered here. Mm-hmm. Let me just touch on one specific point here. Someone is asking in terms of reproduction performance and how to increase conception and which bacteria or toxin could be controlled. Marisabel just explained that piglets are really sensitive to some specific mycotoxins. And we also don't understand completely how the LPS will cause damage in a sow. But generally speaking, when talking about mycotoxins and conception and everything that is related to reproduction in sows, we are talking about one specific mycotoxin, yeah? Which is a little bit different concept here. So we are talking mostly about zearalenone. Zea is a well-known mycotoxin that is causing damage and that is causing harm and reduction on reproductive performance of sows worldwide. Okay, this will be point one, and we can of course explore that a little bit more, but let's save it for another moment. The main point with the toxins here is it's not about the conception itself, but how this will affect the litters and how this will affect the weight gain of the animals. So if, for example, if we find high levels of LPS in the bloodstream for the sows, what does it mean for the piglet that is getting milk for the sow? Because we do know that LPS will be transferred through the milk. So the animals that are getting that milk, the animals that are getting that LPS, what is going to be the impact on that? So I'm not sure if it's about conception itself and in the toxins, but it's more related to the consequences to the litter. And we also have to understand that in sows, the syndrome that reduces the production of milk and leads to an inflammation of the udder is also related to LPS. Yeah? We do understand that there are several reasons for that, and LPS is just part of it, but we can understand also, and this will impact once again the production of milk and the quality of the piglets. So from a conception point of view, so born alive, and estrus and abortion and all of these, I would say that mycotoxin is still played a major role. LPS will affect later on the quality of the litter that is coming from that cell. Okay, I hope this helps you a little bit on your question.
Yes, I would like to add that LPS can influence directly the sow in terms of feed intake, for example, and therefore the stress if the sow eat less, because also the consequence in piglets is direct, right? Okay. Thank you very much for your time. I would like to thank you very much our panelists, Marisa Del Caballero and Felipe, for the help in answering a question. I would like to ask you to answer to the poll that we launch now in order to understand the let's say statistical feedback from you in terms of relating a webinar. Therefore, again, thank you very much for your time and to have joined this meeting and this webinar, and have a nice day or evening to everybody. Thank you.